Sign up for our monthly giveaway. Every month, we give away exclusive Cigars and Sea Stories gear, as well as items for our guests and sponsors. Those are gadgets, gizmos, all sorts of different stuff. When you subscribe to our newsletter by going to cigarsandseastories.com and clicking subscribe, you automatically enter into our monthly giveaway. How you earn points for those giveaway is by sharing the referral link with your network. Every time you share, you earn a point. Every time one of your friends subscribes, you earn an additional 5 points. So go to cigarsandseastories.com right now and subscribe. From the halls of Montezuma to the shores of Tripoli, we fight our country's battles in the air, on land and sea. First to fight for right and freedom and to keep.
Hello, folks, and welcome to another episode of Cigars and Sea Stories. And today we sit down and talk to Paul Szoldra, who is a former Marine, got out in 2010 as a sergeant. And Paul, since he got out, he was a graduate of the University of Tampa. He also wrote and has held other editorial roles with places such as Business Insider and We Are the Mighty. And currently he is the co-host of After Action with Max and Paul. Is also the founder and editor-in-chief of military news site Code Red News and Duffel Blog.
So, my background, I grew up in Connecticut in a small town, joined the Marine Corps after 9/11. I joined the infantry. So, I went to North Carolina, did my, initial training. Well, I did boot camp, of course, South Carolina, North Carolina for infantry training. And then they sent me off to Hawaii. My first unit was 3rd Battalion, 3rd Marines, Weapons Company, 81 Splatoon, the most belligerent bastards of the entire battalion. Very proud of that. Did two deployments with them. I went to, I did the 31st MU, sort of Pacific deployment, Okinawa, Australia, Hong Kong, all that kind of stuff. That was my first one. And then came back, did some training, work up, all that stuff, and then did Afghanistan in 2004, 2005, and came back from that. And I actually re-enlisted and went to a school of infantry as an instructor on the West Coast. Was there for 3 years, and then did a year. My last year, they sent me to a funny little story we can get to later. But my last year, and they sent me to Okinawa to work for 3rd Marine Division. And then I got out from there, went to college, and started Duffel Blog, and did all the kind of stuff I'm doing today.
Right. So you grew up in Connecticut.
Yep.
What town?
Town's called Terryville, Connecticut.
So from Connecticut to California. I'm from Connecticut originally too. That's why I ask.
Oh, no kidding. What part?
Fairfield.
Fairfield. No shit.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm from Terryville, so it's like right by Waterbury.
Right. Not very far.
Not holy crap. All, you're like, we're actually, you and I are unicorns in the Marine Corps. Like,
yes.
You don't get people who join from Connecticut. No.
Like, I know like four of us total.
Yeah. Like, where are you from? And it's like everyone says Texas because like 80% of Marine Corps is from Texas.
Right.
And then you say Connecticut and they're like, well, what's that?
Where the hell is that? What town is that in? Yeah, I'm from Fairfield. So me and another guy went in like the same time. So we were the two for that year from Connecticut, I think. So
pretty that funny. Was the my high school class. It was me and one other dude joined the Marine Corps.
Yeah, that's amazing. Yeah, that was me and one other guy. And I went to a pretty damn big school. This is when I went to it was Fairfield High School at the time. Now it's split again. But, there was like 4,000 kids at my high school. And there was like two or three people that joined the military, period. That was it. It was asinine. It's funny.
Yeah.
Small world, man. That's all.
Yeah.
And then
everybody's way smarter than us in Connecticut.
Way smarter. So. Way. Oh my God. And way richer.
Yeah.
So from Connecticut to Cali, How's that changed? I mean, I know you had the Marine Corps in between there, but, you know, did you think about moving back to the East Coast, or were you like, I'm going to the West Coast, that's it?
Yeah, well, I love California. I was stationed out here at Pendleton for like 3 years, you know, so I love it. And it's, I was up at the north end of the base. So it's like, I know, you know, I know Orange County pretty well, and right. I lived in San Clemente and Laguna Niguel and Dana Point, like while I was stationed here. So, you know, I ended up kind of circumstances were that I came back and, you know, now I live in San Clemente again, like, and so I totally love right. it. Yeah. So anyway, so, I mean, I was stationed here for 3 years. I love California. It's, you know, to me right now it's like, this is my home.
Right.
And, you know, I don't particularly love Connecticut. Like,
no, I
hardly ever go back.
Yeah.
I hardly ever go back. Like, you know, it's not, I can't describe it to somebody, like somebody who doesn't know Connecticut, like, well, what's there? I'm like, I don't fucking know. There's Foxwoods.
That's fucking like, trees and shit.
We got ESPN. And there's a casino, there's two big casinos. Like, there's not, you know, like, you don't go to Connecticut to, like, see it.
And, like, hang know? Out. There's, like, one place that you would go.
Yeah.
Well, it's either the casinos or you go to, like, Mystic. That's, like, it. That's.
Yeah. Yeah. That's yeah. it.
And.
Yeah. So, like, I go there. You know, when I go back, I got this. There's this one deli. That's the one thing that Connecticut, or, well, just the East Coast in general has got going. That like nobody out here, or really, I don't know. I just think it's an East Coast thing. I have parents in Florida. They have the same thing. Nobody knows how to do a fucking deli anywhere other than the East
yeah,
East Coast.
Right.
Because like I go to the same deli. It's called George's Terryville Market. It's like Terryville Bristol line.
Right.
And they make you a sandwich that's like monstrous. Like it's gigantic. It's got to have like a pound of ham, a pound of cheese. They're losing money by giving you this sandwich.
Right.
That large.
Just ridiculous.
And if you know, you go to like Subway and they're like measuring it out, like, you know, one slice, two like, slice, you know, and it's like,
cheese, dude.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And like you go to George's like, you know, piling on ham and cheese and he's like, here you go, you know, like, so that's basically like the one thing I love about Connecticut is, you know, the going to an actual deli. And, you know, I have like, you know, a couple of friends that I still, you know, have from high school, but a lot of them are kind of like faded away and, you know,
yeah,
that kind of thing.
Right.
So my old man is still there, but, you know, it's not, yeah, it's just not like.
It's not a regular.
Well, actually, the one thing I will say, though, is really awesome in Connecticut, like you can't really get anywhere else, is the fall, like the season of fall is just gorgeous. And I love it. I love going on drives and like, you know, just in the country with the leaves and stuff. That's super nice.
Yeah, it is pretty cool.
But yeah, but I got out and I moved around quite a bit. So, while I was in, my mom and like most of my family ended up kind of slowly moving themselves to Florida. I was in for 8 years. So they kind of just, you know, one family member moved and another, and then finally my mother moved. And so when I was getting out, you know, I had to pick like, would I go to Connecticut or Florida? Like, I don't know. And so I ended up going with Florida, which I really don't like Florida that much either.
I don't like Florida
but,
either.
Yeah. But I lived there for 3 years when I got out. I went to college there at University of Tampa. Got my first job out of college that took me to New York. I was there for a bit and then that job, I ended up moving to San Francisco. And then I got another job, which was in LA. And then I left that job and moved further south into Orange County. And, that's where I'm now. So
right.
I basically did this like traversing maneuver across the country and
yeah.
then went, you know, from Northern California to Southern California, and I'm not moving anymore.
Yeah, no, I live in Syracuse now, which is just like cold and snowy. But either way, it's where my wife's from and the whole thing. But we did, we moved to Florida for a little while and I hated it. And then, yeah.
What part of Florida?
We were in Panama City. So
I don't think I've been there.
Yeah, it's a shithole. The beach, the Panama City beach isn't bad, but Panama City, not so nice, man. I was actually working for the Air Force at that time, and yeah, not so cool. But but then my mom, like, when I was in the military, my mom moved to Florida too. It was the same type of thing, but she lived in Melbourne. And then she moved from there to my whole family now packed up from Connecticut, and they all live in Denver, like in the Denver area. So
I love Denver. Denver is freaking awesome. I was just there a few months ago.
It's pretty badass. I concur.
Yeah. Yeah.
So tell me.
I was in. Oh, go ahead.
No, you go ahead. Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say I was in a town called Lakeland, which is.
Yeah, I know Lakeland.
Like basically right in between, Tampa and Orlando. That's where most of my family is now.
All right. Yeah, I'm not a fan, man. I'm not a fan of Florida. My wife's uncle lives there, too, right outside Tampa. Well, actually, not very far from Lakeland. I'm trying to remember the name. Doesn't really matter. It's not that far from Lakeland, though. It's a little bit towards Tampa, though. It's where they do all the freaking, there's like a Driscoll's strawberry farm there or something. It's huge. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, there's a strawberry festival like every year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, so, and then we moved to Delaware. And that might be one of the worst states, too. Just saying.
Well, I mean, that's even worse than Connecticut as far as, like, what the hell do you say?
What is there, right? Here's the craziest part about Delaware. I don't even understand it. Everyone is, and I'm going to catch shit for this. I know I'm going to, but I don't care. There's some ugly freaking people in Delaware, man. Like, everybody's freaking ugly. Like, there's no, I mean, I'm not like some supermodel or anything close to it, right? But like, I have an attractive wife. I have procreated and made attractive kids. But these people are horrific, man. Like, really bad. I mean, there's the occasional. But you know how, like, in, I don't know, Southern California, there's some beautiful people, right?
Yeah, I'd say so.
For the most part, on the average, mainly, they're beautiful people. Not so much in Delaware, man. It's weird. It's really weird. I don't... Like,
I don't have experience in that. You know, the only experience I have with Delaware is just, driving through it in about 10 minutes.
Yeah, on I-95, right?
Takes, like, on I-95.
You go through, you zoom through
Delaware,
Wilmington.
You're leaving it.
Right. You kind of look at Wilmington and you see Newark, Delaware, like, don't even call it Newark, call it Newark. Out of the corner of your eye, and you're like, okay, well, that was Delaware. So it's bizarre, man. Yeah. It really is bizarre. So anyway, and my friends that live there are going to give me so much shit. But literally, how can you go to like a really big gym, like a gym, and there's really not one attractive person in there? How is that possible? Right? Anyway, sorry. I had to go on that rant. So
yeah.
So tell me about Duffel Blog, and I mean I read it, and I also read Code Red News. But how did Duffel Blog, like, how did that happen? It's fantastic, by the way. But how did it, like, that happen right after you got out, or what did that begin while you were in still?
No, that was after I got out. It's so when I was in, I mean, I was pretty much, surprisingly, I was a pretty, like, moto Marine. I was super brainwashed, like, into it in the first, 2 years or something. Like, I'm a super boot, but I'm like, yeah, like, Semper Fi Marine Corps, you know, like, everything First Sergeant says is the word of God. Like, you know, it was just very, you know, over the top. You know, and then, you know, as you get more experience and you kind of put your time in, you kind of some things you get cynical over or whatever. And I think coming from Connecticut, like the way I was when I was a teenager, like and sort of my thought processes and, my like how I felt about issues and stuff like that come from where I came from and where I grew up. And you go to the Marine Corps and then you kind of are put into these, like you're put among all these people who have different views, different opinions, and you kind of like fall into that, and
straight
you kind of
culture,
like,
shock.
Yeah. Yeah. So anyway, like after 2-3 years you're in the Marine Corps, then I kind of feel like I fall back to, just who I usually was. And I mean, growing up, I was a class clown. I was a total fucking smart ass, like in high school. Like I had this detention slip from an art teacher that I kept for like the longest time because I thought it was the funniest thing ever. Like I was such an asshole. I feel terrible now. But like I was always making, I hated her class so bad. I hated our class. So I was like always interrupting and I was talking and this and that. So she wrote me this detention slip that was like detention for 2 days for constant interruption, swearing, profanity, loud, like she wrote all these things on it. Like it was this listing and I'm like, this is great. I kept it for like for a freaking awesome. Long time. It was so funny. But yeah, so that's kind of who I am. Like I'm a joking kind of person. I, you know, I don't take very much seriously. And so I got out of the Marine Corps and went to college completely aimless, having no clue what I was going to do. And so I decided, like any other veteran going on the GI Bill, I would spend my hard earned GI Bill money on a business management degree.
Yes. Because
they don't have enough of those.
Right. Mine was security management.
Oh, that's even better. That's
it's like underwater basketball.
You're basically trained to be you must have been trained to be a CIA officer.
I guess. Something. Yeah. It's so stupid.
But so I get accepted, I go to college, I start on this business track, you know, and then I went back and forth. I wasn't sure what I wanted to do. And so I dabbled and thought like, oh, maybe I'll do marketing. And then I realized that we had at the University of Tampa, we had this program for entrepreneurship, like an actual, you know, entrepreneur track that you could get a degree in. And so I ended up changing my major to that. And that's really kind of why Duffel Blog even exists, because I probably wouldn't have done anything had it not been for this program. So When I started on this thing, like you basically go through the program and you're, by the end of it, you're supposed to like have the tools, you're supposed to have a business plan. You should be able to launch a business, or at least have all the stuff in place where you could. And so you start off, your first thing is like to do a feasibility study on a business idea.
Right.
And then, you know, then you go through it. And so I started out thinking that I would do a business to help veterans, like help them in their transition going to college.
Like every other guy getting out.
Yeah, exactly. Like, I'm going to start a veteran nonprofit, you know, or a t-shirt company. I don't know.
Or a coffee company.
So I thought, I was like, I'll do this. I'll try to do something like that, because when I got out and I picked the University of Tampa, luckily it's a great school and I loved it, but I literally saw it in the GI Jobs magazine and I just like saw how much it cost, which was a lot. And I said, oh, that must be a good one, you know, and that's kind of like how I picked my school. And so I figured like, hey, I could, you know, make something on the web that helps vets like pick a school better. You know, it was sort of like my idea at the time was like what I was pitching was like a sort of like a Yelp for veterans, like a Yelp for colleges kind of thing.
Yeah.
Gotcha. And so anyway, during that time, like I was working on this, making this whole thing and building a website and this and that. I was looking into like content marketing, and you have to have blogs, and this is even before social media is really a big deal. So you start with blogs. And so I made like a GI Bill tips blog, and I made some other one. And then I also was like, you know, I bet I could make something funny. Like, you know, I really love the content from The Onion, but they always screw up like military ranks or the circumstances around like what, you know, how people talk or whatever. Like you can tell that the writers are not veterans. And so I was like, yeah, I'll just start this one and I'll call it Duffel Blog. And so I ended up making this website. So it was like collegeveteran.com/duffelblog. And I posted the first article ever, which was the Chair Force article. And you know, it was, you know, nobody read it, of course, because it was a brand new thing. But I posted it, you know, to Facebook and like Twitter, I think. And then I think I sent it to like Reddit, and I think like the R military subreddit, you know, they kind of saw it, and you know, a couple hundred people saw it here or there. but I remember they were commenting on it and they were thinking like the whole website was associated with satire. Like it was all a joke website. The whole college veteran website was a joke. And you know, obviously that's not good. like my content marketing idea really backfired if that's the case. And so it was just maybe a month or two after I made this separate blog that I separated it and made its own domain name and, you know, had two things now, Duffel Blog, and then the other one was called College Veteran. And, you know, kind of did them both on the side while I was still in college. And then, you know, eventually I kind of shuttered the College Veteran thing and then decided to focus on Duffel Blog because that was the thing that was actually, you know, bearing some fruit and looked like that was the thing to do.
So really why writing? Was there like a release there, or was it just because you decided that you were good at it, or you know what I mean?
I'm trying to think back of I can't remember. So there's a book that I read that I love. I consider it the book that changed my life and like made me really love writing. Like in high school, you know, before the Marine Corps, I enjoyed writing. You know, I wrote like, you know, short stories here or there and like, you know, just nothing big, like nothing that I would even remember to like recall or anything, but I definitely enjoyed the practice of it. And anyway, I can't remember. I think I was out. I was in college. I think I may have read it during that time, but it's called On Writing Well. The author is William Zinsser. It's a classic of just it's a classic book because it's been out for 30 some odd years, and he basically makes it makes writing pretty accessible. Like it's not it just kind of shows you know use words, you know, use words that are like, use the regular word, not the one that's going to make you, you know, sound all like smart, you know, like the one that nobody knows what the hell you're saying. Be conversational, all these things. And so like made me kind of get a better understanding for writing and, you know, made me enjoy it. And so with Duffel Blog, I mean, with, as far as writing, I mean, that was the medium. I actually going back now that I think about it, I was like a blogger before, like way back in the day. Like I used to just blog on my own personal website, like my dumb random thoughts of a teenager.
Right. Almost like a journal type thing.
Yeah. Like back in the old days of the internet, you know, people would have, they would just blog like their day. Like I do right. this or that, you know, yeah. I did that too. You know, I was a teenager. I was always stuck on the computer. And so, yeah, I just went to the default as, you know, as far as blogging, Duffel Blog, like you write, you know, and I wasn't about to do videos or anything crazy. Right. So yeah. writing was the way to go. And so, you know, that's what I went with.
That's awesome. Well, it's funny as shit. So is it just you or is how many other people write?
Well, it's just me as far as the I'm the editor in chief. So yeah. I see everything that gets posted, and I'm take care of like the calendar and the social media posts uh-huh. and all that kind of stuff. But I started out, it was just me, and so I wrote it started as like I'll write once in a while, and then it became I'll write like Mondays and Fridays, and then I think it was like Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and then eventually somebody, someone who is in, a guy who is, I think he was in Kuwait, emails me out of the blue and he says, I love your site. This is so funny. Can I write for you? And I had not even thought of that. maybe I can get other people to write for this. It was just like, I'll write this, you know, and maybe it'll be funny and people will laugh and, you know, whatever. And he says like, hey, can I write for you? And I was like, well, you know, I can't pay you anything. Like it doesn't make any money. And he says, oh, I don't care. Like I just want to write. This is great. I want to contribute to this. And that was kind of how that started. You know, I went from zero contributors to, you know, now there's, I think we're probably over 100. And they're, you know, every branch, veteran, active duty, you know, men, women, officer, enlisted, you name it, just kind of runs the gamut. And, you know, some people have written in the past and then they kind of fizzle out as, you know, life, you know, comes up. And you know, then we, and then it's like, you know, over the years, there's just people keep emailing and, you know, wanting to write, and, you know, I set them up and, get them going. And now I'm at a position where I can actually pay them per article, but
right.
for quite a long time, for quite a long time, like no one got any pay and nobody cared. Like it was just, we love this site. This gives me an outlet. It gives me a release to, you know, basically bitch about something in the military that's bothering me, you know, in a funny way. And, that's really still, even with pay involved, I think for a lot of the contributors now, you know, it's all about that. Like it's just a fun thing to do, you know?
So. Right. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, exactly. I mean, it keeps people busy too. So that's pretty cool. So Code Red News, this is,
well, I want to back up 1 second. Cause okay. I think, there's one thing that I think is a good, like I say this, I said this a bunch of times, I'll say it again, but, you know, I describe the kind of the contributor side of things like this, like, you know, if you're in the military, let's say, I mean, you're in the Marines, you are in a formation, you know, the first sergeant, whoever is in front of you, and you're like, you know, well, this is such bullshit. When the fuck am I getting out of here? You're waiting for the CEO and he's like, you know, jerking off in the company office for all you know, like he's just, you know, taking his time, and you're looking to your left and right to your buddy, and you're like, this is such bullshit, fucking CEO is such a dick, you know, or whatever, right? Your sphere of influence is basically you, two people, three people, or whatever it is. And but, you know, with Duffel Blog, if you're a writer on Duffel Blog, or, you know, my early days, and it was just me, and I could actually do that same thing. I could criticize something that I thought was dumb, but the sphere of influence was much larger.
Much larger, right?
This is reaching perhaps, you know, thousands, maybe tens of thousands of people. You know, now it's, you have the chance, if you're writing on Duffel Blog, that is a pretty good chance that plenty of people in the Pentagon
Absolutely.
Will be reading it, you
yeah.
know?
I mean, and so, even like, Mattis has made comments on it, right? So
yeah, Mattis is we count Mattis as a fan. He has one of the best things he did was he used to be, before it was SecDef, he was a fellow at Stanford,
right?
And they put up his bio, and at the bottom of his bio he told them to put this line that says he has also been frequently satirized at duffelblog.com.
That's fantastic.
Which I just love. So
for sure.
Yeah. He's been really great. Like he's said some really kind things about Duffel Blog over the years. So I've been very thankful for that.
Right. Just awesome stuff, man. Some of it really is funny. I've got it, like, it comes up first on my feed. So I just laugh my ass off almost daily, you know? So, cause I also read The Onion as well still. It just makes me laugh. Cause it's
yeah,
just
of
so,
course.
It's,
I love The Onion. I don't know what's better though.
There, right?
The whole, like, Clickhole is just Clickhole. Like obviously The Onion is running Clickhole, but
right.
Oh my God. I probably laugh way more from Clickhole now than I do from just The Onion.
Yeah.
I think too, because I was in the serious digital media and, like, you know, a journalist and everything. So mm-hmm. Clickhole, like, makes fun of, like, it's basically making fun of, like, clickbaity sites.
Yes.
And so it's like, it's doubly funny to me, you know? So,
yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. So you've worked for a lot of folks though.
Yeah, writing, a few. I worked at, my main one is I worked for Business Insider for, about 4 years with a break in between. So I worked for Business Insider, and then, the break period, I worked for a year as the executive editor of We Are the Mighty, which is like a, you know, when I started there, we launched this new website, which has been around, I guess, for, I don't know, 2 or 3 years now.
Yep.
I don't know where it is on the in the years. But and then so I did like BI for 2 years, went to Weird and Mighty, and then I went back to BI for 2 years, and then I just recently I went and I decided to take the risk and go do Duffel Blog / Code Red News and make that the full-time thing. So
man, so because the thing that's awesome about Code Red, sorry, I don't want to step on
I'm
you,
relying on my no I'm just I'm taking the entrepreneur finally. So I've done, Duffel Blog has been
the leap.
five years of, doing it on the side. So I work basically 6 days a week. Like I would do Business Insider stuff 5 days a week, and then I'd have 2 days off, and then one of those days off I would be basically editing and scheduling Duffel Blog articles. Mm-hmm. Like, and doing the social media stuff. And finally decided, like, I think I can do it, and I'll take the plunge. And so now I'm relying on that high quality VA healthcare.
Wrong. Yes. shit. Yeah, man, for sure.
So keep me in your prayers. Don't let me get cancer or something.
Absolutely.
Because I don't want to go to VA Long Beach any more than I have to.
Oh my God. Yeah. I'm not even going to go there. I've talked about it enough. So, cause I have worked for the VA. That's where I sort of get my health care. It just depends. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. But so the best part about Code Red is that it's still, even with Code Red, like you're talking about real stuff, like stuff that's happening, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it still has like not the most serious tone to it. So it's nice and refreshing to read news that's like written. It's written like you and I would talk for the most part.
Yeah,
it's
that's not kind of the goal. That's really the goal with it. I did this like introductory post. If you go to coderedians.com and go to the about, you'll see like kind of what I'm thinking, what my feelings are with reporting on the military and how I think, things should be. And so, the idea for the site is basically, real national security reporting, military reporting, with my opinion. And if I get other writers in there, then it'll be their opinion too. Like, it's just, calling out bullshit when we see it. So,
right,
a great example today, right? Today I had this, today it was this article. It's a really good article. I don't fault them for writing it, but the Defense One had this article, and it was like, I forgot what the headline was, but it was something like the U.S. commanders, top U.S. commanders in Afghanistan are being positive, or they think like, they're going to give it another shot, like something like that. I forgot what it was, but it was almost like this like puffy, like feel good, the top U.S. commanders are like, yeah, we can finally go after the Taliban. We're feeling really confident here because the Afghan forces are doing great, blah, 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 and that's like, and it's very straight news reporting. But, in an article about Afghanistan, I've done a couple at Code Red. If I write about an article in Afghanistan, I'm going to be like, I'll write all this stuff. And then I'll literally write like, okay, but that's bullshit. And here's why.
Well, it's like the title of one of the articles that I read, I think it was yesterday, is "The War in Afghanistan is Going So Great, the Pentagon Doesn't Even Want You to Know About It." Like, really?
Yeah.
Like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Man. Yeah. That's great. So I want to.
Like you see it.
It's like it's funny too, because I'm like going to write what I feel and what I think is right. Like, I'm still going to report the facts, quote people properly, all the same journalism procedures that I know and well and love. But I'm also not going to like sugarcoat stuff or kind of like,
right.
Just, I'm basically well,
cool
going to call it exactly how I would see it.
Shit like that. It's awesome. It's great.
but you actually see this, you see defense reporters calling it like they see it every single day.
Yeah.
They just do it on Twitter. You follow all the, if you follow the people who write about the military, they tweet all day long and they are saying their opinions. They're telling you like, here's what they, you can tell how they feel about Afghanistan. You can tell how they feel about the F-35 and how big of a clusterfuck it is. Like you can tell where their biases are, but the difference is that they don't, they're not going to write it on their articles. I will. I'm okay with being biased. I'm biased in favor of not being like, not being like a total lackey to defense contractors and like thinking that the DOD, like what they say is actually the word of God. Like I don't like if they, if they're lying to you, I'll say they're lying to you. You know, that's just how I feel. And
stop wasting money on dumb shit and all that other shit, you know?
Yeah.
It's the exactly. You're right. Things like the F-35 is just a shit show.
Yeah. There's a great movie, I don't know if you've seen it, but there's a movie called Pentagon Wars. It's actually based on an old book. Have you heard of this or read it?
No, I haven't.
Okay, so the movie, the book it's based on, I haven't read the book, but the book is written by this Air Force colonel. He was like at the Pentagon. He was in charge of this like a weapons program. Like he was the officer in charge of a weapons program, and he writes this book about his experience and how what a nightmare it was, and just all the requirements and all the craziness of contracting and, you know, generals saying like, add this, add that. Right. So they made a movie about it. The movie is actually really funny. It's got like Kelsey Grammer in it and Carrie Elwes. Yeah. And it's about the Bradley fighting vehicle. And like, they start off with like saying, oh, it's going to be a reconnaissance vehicle. It's going to fit, you know, 10 people or whatever. And then they say, well, let's add a turret to this thing. Give them some firepower. And let's add some night vision. Let's add this. Let's add that. Like it's got to float, you know, all this crap to it. And by the end of it, it's like the worst vehicle. It doesn't do anything that it's actually designed for well. It's just this crazy boondoggle. And I remember watching that movie, and it was pretty recently when I first watched it. And as soon as I got done with it, I'm like, oh my God, that is the
F-35. It is the
like
F-35,
nothing
right?
has changed.
Yeah,
like the F-35, it's like, you know, hey, let's make this new fighter. And then the Marine Corps comes in and it's like, we need it to vertically take off and land. We need that. And they're like, all right. And then, you know, then the Air Force is like, we don't want the A-10 anymore. We hate the A-10. Let's get rid of it. We need to make this a CAS jet too. So it's like a bomber, a fighter, an A-10 replacement that can take off vertically and land. It can share intelligence. It can do this or that, blah, blah, blah. And it's a fucking $1 trillion. And like, it's just, I don't know. It's just like, I look at that. It's like a total nightmare.
Oh, yeah.
And,
the whole thing, you know, it's everything negative about the whole like defense contracting system. It's everything that could go wrong fucking went wrong. Unbelievable.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, totally.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
Well, that's crazy, bro. I love it.
Yeah.
I love it. So what's on the horizon for you? Is it just these two projects? Get this flying high, hopefully, and make it go with the true entrepreneur thing?
Well, I'm working on, I'm doing some stuff with, I'm doing, you know, the thing with Duffel Blog, of course. Code Red just launched and it's kind of slow going. I have very small expectations for it. That way, you know, if it crushes like my small expectations, then that's great. And if it doesn't,
it doesn't
then
crush
I'm not
your
disappointed.
Spirit, right?
Yeah. And then, you know, other than that, I'm actually I got two things coming up. Unfortunately, I'm not ready to like announce them, but one is, I can't say the one, but one is it's a Kickstarter thing for, how can I say this? Well, okay, so we're going to do a Kickstarter pretty soon, but it's for this specific product.
Okay.
It's a game.
Gotcha.
So I'll just leave it at that. And then later on this year, we're actually throwing and we have not yet announced this yet, but we're doing an event.
Cool.
So we can actually like meet our fans and have a jolly old time.
like Duffel Blog, the
fan
live
base.
Show, right?
Yeah, exactly. So, I actually did this Like me and a whole bunch of the writers, about a year and a half ago, we all like got together, at this like house we rented, and we just like drank our faces off and had a great old time telling stories and, you know, just doing general buffoonery, for like 2 days. And so I figure like, hell, we should probably do this for the fans. So, but it'll be more than just that. I mean, there'll be actual like acts and things to see and stuff like that. So, should be fun, but I'm still in like really early stages of, planning it and getting it all worked out.
Right. So. And the podcast that's on again, off again, kind of when you can do it. You want to talk about that at all? It's up to you though.
Oh yeah. Yeah. So I mean, me and Max and Tim Lance, we do a podcast called After Action, or the After Action Show. It's, if you looked it up on like iTunes, After Action, with Max and Paul. And it's basically just me and him just kind of bullshit. And we pick like a couple of topics in the news. We talk about them. We usually do these crazy segues that, you know, just these tangents that go, we're like, how the hell did we even get on this topic? But people who listen generally, think it's entertaining enough.
It is entertaining. You know, like, we have Adam Driver's moto tag, dude. Really?
Yeah.
It's hysterical. I love it. Kylo Ren's moto tat.
I thought for sure he had one, but I don't know. He probably edited it out.
I would say it's edited out.
He's got it. He was in. He was at Camp Pendleton, like, you know. He went down.
Who doesn't? Everyone has to have a moto tat. And if you don't, they're like a unicorn, like you had said earlier. They're the unicorn.
Oh, folks. I know.
And he's got to have one, but maybe doesn't. I don't know.
I got mine. I got mine in beautiful Jacksonville, North Carolina.
That's I got mine too.
USMC.
Buzz's tattoo.
Got my USMC for $60.
Yeah, I got the old bulldog with the USMC under it, and then I have the meat tag. Those are the ones I got. I mean, I have a lot more tattoos than that, but those are the freaking moto tattoos. Oh man!
You know what's funny? So my moto tat, I actually got it covered up, but I got it covered up with a bigger tat. Like this was in 2006 or 2005? I think it's 2006. It was the Commandant changed the rules, and they were saying we're going to outlaw sleeve tattoos. And I had always wanted a sleeve, but I never like did it. And they changed this order. They did this order where it's like, we're not going to allow sleeve tattoos. And they gave you a date, and it was like, if you're before this date and you have a sleeve tattoo, we will grandfather you in. Right. You'll be okay. You're fine in the Marine Corps. Of course, they fucked all those guys over later on. Of course,
right, of course,
because they're kicking them out and giving them bad fitness reports and all this other stuff. But they grandfathered you in, and then they said if you have like the outline of it by such and such date, you can finish it. Like, you have to get it documented, right? So I like immediately go out. I fucking get the outline. I get the outline on my arm.
Shit.
And like, I have him do it, and I had him tattoo me, like, do the outline part. And that was like, you know, a solid, I don't know, 4 or 5 hours or whatever it was. And I had this outline for quite a while, got it, you know, got my picture taken, and then ended up finishing it up. But, so yeah, I don't have my USMC, but if you look closely, you can still see it on my arm.
Still in there in the design.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
It's still there. Yeah.
Well, so let us know where's the best places to find you. What's the, your websites and social media and everything like that.
Yeah. I mean, of course, if you're listening to this, hopefully you already know it, duffelblog.com. Make sure you spell it right. It's D-U-F-F-E-L. There's an asshole who I don't know who it is, but bought the misspelled version, and it's like a shitty spam site or something.
Right.
So, duffelblog.com, my own personal website, is paulsoldier.com. I hope maybe you'll spell that out, or I don't know if you want me to spell it out, but,
yeah, I'll spell it out.
Paulsoldier.com.
Well, everything will be in the show notes too. So,
yeah. So paulsoldier.com, it's, S is in Sam, Z is in zebra, O L D is in dog, R A. Yes, I've done that before. And you can find me on Twitter at Paul&nbsp. That's where I usually am sharing lots of my thoughts and random bullshit. And then, you know, Facebook and all that stuff. And if you had a listener or something that wanted to email me, you can find that on my website. It's got all my like contact info there. So, yeah, that's about it.
What's your favorite social media platform?
Twitter. Twitter by far. Yeah.
Right.
I use Twitter like all the time. I'm hardly ever on Facebook. I mean, I'm on Facebook. If I didn't have the business case, if I didn't have to like post up the Duffel Blog and stuff, I would say no to Facebook. Like Facebook makes me upset. Like I don't get happy being on Facebook.
No.
You know, like it used to be that you'd see like your friends and your family or whatever, but I don't know. I'm not digging Facebook anymore. I like Instagram now a whole lot more because it's like you get to actually choose what you see. Facebook does this algorithm bullshit and you know, you don't get to see everything that you wanted.
Right.
Instagram, you know, you see all these photos and it's great. But I use Twitter, the most, and I just really like using Twitter. I'm sharing whatever I'm reading and like talking about stuff in the news, and I'm usually tweeting at, you know, other journalists or, you know, making fun of like Max
or,
you know, or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, the cool thing about Twitter for me, and I think for a lot of people that is, it's unique, is it's the one platform where you can really like reach anybody.
Right.
And I'm talking about like celebrities or people like who are like usually out of reach. Like you can't find, I don't know, you're not going to find like The Rock's email address that he actually reads. Like you're not going to find that online, but you could tweet at him and it's such a short little message that he actually might respond to you. And that's super cool to me, you know, like, so like people are, if people are like, you know, interacting with me on Twitter, like I'll definitely usually respond to them. Like if I'm not super busy or whatever, and you know, if I'm paying attention, just cause it's like, I don't know, it's just there. It's like a cool thing. So,
And it's like real time too.
Of course,
it's not as, spread out, I guess is the best word. It's everything's
kind of, I get all my news. I get all the news stuff. Like I'll see whatever breaking stuff news wise will happen on Twitter, and then you'll see it, you know, you'll see it like 30 minutes later on Facebook. So if you're like me and you're like really a news junkie, Twitter is the place you have to be. So.
For sure. Well, Paul, we appreciate you coming on, man, a lot. I want to be respectful of your time, but any other things that you want to talk about real quick?
No, not at all. I just, I really appreciate you letting me come on the podcast. And the only thing I would like to say, I'll just offer some advice to anyone out there who might be listening, is make good choices.
Make good choices. I like it. Your decisions have consequences.
Yeah. Yeah. Don't fuck up or all of us are going to be in formation on Monday morning. So don't just do the right thing out there.
Don't get arrested in Myrtle Beach on a Saturday. Okay.
Yeah, exactly.
Because they won't let you out on Sunday. That's a whole nother story though. But all right, man, we appreciate it. Thanks for coming on, and everybody check us out at all of our social media, and thanks for listening.